We are gathered here today to remember with great affection, gratitude and respect, Maryam Mirzakhani, beloved wife, mother, daughter and sister, our esteemed colleague, brilliant mathematician admired the world over, and yet a person of great humility about her exceptional gifts and abilities. On behalf of the Stanford community, it is my privilege as the Dean for Religious Life here to welcome you, Maryam's family, friends, and colleagues to this service, which it is Stanford's honor to host. We will be hearing this afternoon from those who knew her best and those with whom she worked in mathematics about the huge impact she made in her life. And we will be listening to music and readings that have great meaning for her and her family.
Good afternoon. My name is Payman Amiri. I'm chairman of the board at Islamic Cultural Center of Northern California. On behalf of the Muslim community of Bay Area, I want to extend our condolences to the family of Maryam, to the Stanford University, the math department, to all Iranian Americans who live in Bay Area, and to all the women who struggle every day to prove that they are as equal as to their male counterparts. I will be reciting several verses from Holy Book of Quran. I'm not going to recite it in Arabic. I start by verse number 2 in chapter 67. In name of God, the mercy giving, the merciful. God tells us, I have created death and life. Death is creation of God. I have created death and life. So in this period of time, with your own struggle, you reveal the best of your character. Some of us get to live a lot longer. Some, like Maryam, lived very short life. However, in such short time, she revealed best of characters. She had such an impactful life. She was beacon of hope for all the women throughout the world. What was the most impressive personality of her was the humility. In my lifetime, I met many, many smart Nobel laureates. But what was most impressive about Maryam wasn't that she was a wonderful mathematician, it was her humility. In continuation, I selected three verses from chapter 66. In chapter 66, God picks four women as examples for all of us. In first example, there are two women, wives of two prophets. And God tells us there is no mercy by association. Third example is wife of Pharaoh, Asiya. And God tells us there's no guilt by association. And the last person is Maryam, or Mary, mother of Jesus. A woman who had no brother, lost her father at a very young age, so had no association with men, but became such a noble person. Thank you. God has given examples of disbelievers, the wives of Noah and Lot, who married two of our righteous servants, but betrayed them. Their husbands could not help them against God. It was said, both of you enter to the fire of hell. And then God has also given examples of believers, Pharaoh's wife, who said, Lord, build me a house near you in the garden. Save me from Pharaoh and his actions. Save me from the tyrant. And Mary, daughter of Imran, she guarded her chastity. And then we breathe into her from our own spirit. She accepted the truth of her Lord's words and scriptures. She was truly devout. So Maryam's fame was not her association to her husband or to her father. Her fame was her actions in what she did. And I hope the examples that I picked from Holy Book of Quran, and God picked these four women to highlight these four characters, reminds us of what Maryam accomplished in such short life. Thank you for your attention.
My name is Eleni Onel, and I'm a professor of mathematics here at Stanford and the chair of mathematics department as well. I had the honor and privilege to be Maryam's colleague and friend. She was a brilliant mathematician, a wonderful person, and an inspiration for so many. She was friendly and warm, intensely private and modest, but also extremely determined and relentless, always holding herself and others to very high standards. Maryam may be best known for winning a Fields Medal, but she received many other very prestigious awards and honors, including a Simons Investigator Award, a Clay Research Award, and was elected a member of both the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and all this before she even turned 40. I first heard of Maryam through her work, as she was finishing her PhD at Harvard. Her doctoral thesis was simply amazing, but for me, the most fascinating part was her proof of Witten's conjecture. A few years later, once she joined our department, I remember asking her, Maryam, how did you realize that the growth rate of geodesics would have anything to do with Witten's conjecture? It's so unexpected, nobody would have ever guessed there was something to do with each other. Her face lit up, as it always did when she talked, especially about mathematics or about her family. And she said, oh, it's really nothing. It wasn't that hard to see it was a relation. I was just playing around with those formulas. Anyone could have seen that. That was classic Maryam, always very modest and humble about her achievements. She was proud of what she accomplished, but never relished in the publicity and fame that ensued. Quite the opposite. After she won the Fields Medal, she did not want us to hold any event celebrating this remarkable achievement. Eventually, somebody managed to convince her that we should at least have a specialty in our department to celebrate this. Maryam reluctantly came to it, but you could clearly see she did not enjoy at all the attention she was getting. She kept saying, I don't know why they gave this to me. There are so many other deserving people. For once, here was something we knew that Maryam did not. This spring, I had a wonderful meeting with Maryam. We met for coffee outdoors on campus and talked for a long time about many different things. We talked about the department, we talked about math and our research. The conversation even drifted to our families and children. Maryam's daughter was just finishing kindergarten, and my son and daughter were in middle school. We talked about how fortunate we both were to have had such amazing teachers and mentors to inspire and challenge us. And we hope the same for our children, and that they will find and follow their passion, whatever it may be. I was so refreshed and hopeful after that meeting. I told everybody how wonderful it was and how well Maryam seemed to be doing. Of course, I knew she was quite sick, but you could not tell it by just looking at her or talking to her. She had this grueling traveling schedule, going back and forth every 2 weeks to New York for treatment and tests. So I asked her, Maryam, how do you do it? Where do you find all this strength? I'm just exhausting thinking of your schedule. And she just smiled and said, oh, it's really not that bad. It's fine. I don't think I ever heard her complain about something or say that something was too hard. I've always admired her strength and determination to go through whatever life throws at us. Nothing could stop her. Nothing could make her give up. She was a fighter until the very end. It is still very hard to imagine that someone of her extraordinary energy, determination, and brilliance could be taken away from us at such a young age. It's such a tremendous loss for her family and friends, for our department in Stanford, and for mathematics in general. But I close my eyes and I can see Maryam's face smiling, radiating all this inner strength and determination. Her passion for mathematics has touched so many lives and will continue to be an inspiration for many more. So it is fitting that on this occasion, as we remember Maryam and her many contributions, I am proud and grateful to announce that Ruzbeh Yassini and Anush Ansari have endowed a graduate fellowship in Maryam's Mirzakhani's honor to enable future aspiring mathematicians to follow their passion and dreams, just like Maryam did. Maryam's passing left a huge hole in our heart, and we will miss her dearly. But her example will continue to inspire us and many generations to come, a bright and shining light leading the way.
Well, it's an honor to be able to participate in this event in memory of Maryam Mirzakhani. This is the third memorial for Maryam that I've attended. And although this is a sad occasion, it's truly gratifying to see how many people have been inspired by her story and how many lives she has touched. Let me open with a quote from one of them, a former undergraduate from Stanford I met recently, named Danielle. And she wrote to me about a reading course she did with Maryam. She wrote, during my time with her, I explored various questions related to the figure eight knot, the torus, etc. Each week was a different topic. I learned from her diligence and calm methodology how to think through such problems, which she would formulate as if she were constructing a work of art. She would brush on the blackboard the basic fundamentals that she would ensure I had a strong grasp of, and then slowly layer upon various colors of detailing that would give a more vivid illustration of the problem we were tackling. I am now entering the third year of my PhD in bioinformatics. Her impact on my life is unforgettable, and I would not be here at Harvard, which is where I met her, if not for her support and encouragement. So I am the chairman of the mathematics department at Harvard, and I first met Maryam in the year 2000, and I became her thesis advisor. So I've had the privilege of knowing her as a student and as a friend and also as a colleague. And she was an unpretentious and open person who combined modesty with fearless ambition when it came to mathematics. So for this occasion, I'd like to describe for you some of my impressions of Maryam's path from graduate student to world-renowned mathematician and field medalist. I'll start with just a few anecdotes, and then I'll end with some slides illustrating something about her work. So let me first say what it was like to meet Maryam in graduate school. I was giving an informal seminar, and graduate students were talking on interesting research papers of the day. And Maryam started sitting in on my seminar, and then she started stopping by my office to talk. And the first thing I noticed right off was that she was using her notebook backwards. And then I realized she was, at that time, taking notes in Farsi. But what really struck me was the nature of the questions that she had to ask me. Now, of course, all graduate students come to ask questions about mathematics, but Miriam's questions were unusually imaginative. They were more like science fiction stories or detective stories. They included detailed scenarios for parts of the mathematical landscape where, in fact, little was known. And she would often describe one of these scenarios to me and then turn to me and say, "Is it right?" as if I would know. And when I later learned that she once had the ambition to be a writer herself, this made perfect sense. She was crafting narratives to make sense of the world she was going to do research in. Now, doing mathematical research is like climbing a mountain that no one has ever climbed before. And along the way, there are steep cliffs that have to be scaled, but perhaps the hardest task is to just imagine a route all the way to the summit. Now, the gold medal winners of high school math Olympiads, like Maryam, are already adept at scaling cliffs. But Miriam's ability to craft mathematical narratives convinced me that she had also the more unusual skills necessary to plan a route to the summit, to plan an ascent that might take months or years to execute. Let me just briefly describe how her thesis came about. I asked her to give a talk about McShane's formula, which is a beautiful and somewhat mysterious equation that expresses the number one as an infinite sum over the lengths of closed loops on a torus. A torus is a surface that's shaped like a donut. And when Maryam presented this paper in my seminar, it was clear that she had deeply understood the argument behind this mysterious formula. And in fact, she used the formula to do something new. She used it to calculate the volume of what is called a moduli space. Now, I should say that these moduli spaces are central players in mathematics. And calculating their volume is as fundamental as calculating the area of a circle, pi r squared. But it's much more challenging. And in fact, finding these kinds of formulas for volumes is a topic still at the frontiers of mathematical research today. So what she did was she had observed that McShane's formula could be used to calculate the volume of at least the simple moduli space. Well, a few weeks later, she stopped by my office and explained to me that she now had a version of McShane's formula that worked not just for the donut, but for a surface with any number of handles, and that as a result, she could now compute the volumes of all moduli spaces. And then a few weeks later, she explained to me how she could use her argument to also give a new estimate for the number of simple closed curves of a given length on one of these complicated surfaces. And then soon after that, she mentioned that she could derive a formula of central importance in string theory physics using her deep understanding of how the volumes changed as the surfaces changed shape. This string theory formula was first conjectured by Witten and then proved by Konsevich, two other field medalists in the 1990s. Maryam found a completely new approach to this problem, and the circle of ideas she introduced had worldwide impact. So the story of her thesis was a remarkable development with humble origins that began with curves on a donut and ended with a new perspective on a central problem in mathematical physics. She immediately became a major player on the mathematical stage. As you probably know, she then went on to Princeton and then became a professor at Stanford. And in 2014, she was awarded the Fields Medal, the so-called Nobel Prize of Mathematics. So I'd like to also say a word about some of her later work, which was recognized by the Fields Medal. It has to do with a connection between the dynamics of a ball moving in a billiard table and, again, surfaces possibly with many handles. So if you'd like to study the long-term behavior of a billiard ball bouncing off the sides of a traditional rectangular table, you can relate that to the theory of curves on a donut, because if you identify the two opposite sides of the table, you get a cylinder. And then when you glue together the two ends of the cylinder, you get a donut. And the billiard motion in the original table goes over to a new dynamical system on this closed surface. However, if you tried to analyze the dynamics of billiards in a more complicated table, say you had a pentagonal-shaped table on which you were studying this mechanical system, then when you tried to reduce it to the study of a surface, you would get a surface with two handles. And more complicated tables might give surfaces with three or four handles, increasing topological complexity. And the challenge that Maryam took on was to uncover universal patterns in dynamical systems by working on this particular simple model. This is a common strategy in mathematics. Dynamical systems are all around us. They include the physical laws that govern the motion of the planets in their orbits. They include the fluctuations of the stock market, and they govern even the beating of the human heart. Maryam's contribution lies in the abstract part of the theory of dynamics, but it is part of a very broad endeavor that connects all sciences and lies at the basis of the very idea of scientific prediction. Now, very simple model systems, like these billiards, can sometimes have very complicated behavior. The behavior might be described by fractals, such as the Mandelbrot set. But what Maryam showed, together with her coworkers, some of whom are in the audience today, was that dynamics on surfaces, including billiards, is always governed by algebraic laws. It is not a fractal regime. Different tables can have different behavior, but the types of behavior are distinguished by algebraic equations, not structures that are impossible to quantify. Now, I myself had made a minor breakthrough in the year 2004 by treating this theory in the case of surfaces with just two handles. The proof that Maryam and her co-workers gave, however, which handled all the remaining cases, was a true tour de force. So to give you a little more insight into what Maryam did, and also to share some of my memories of her, let me show you some slides. So this is a picture of Maryam. I believe this is when she first came to Stanford, and it's very much how I remember her as a student at Harvard. And this is a picture from around the time of her Fields Medal. And I've included this to give you an idea of her mathematical process. Maryam worked very visually and with geometric intuition. And here she is studying surfaces by drawing on a sprawling piece of paper on the floor of her home here in Palo Alto. Now, this slide illustrates the surfaces we've been talking about. The ordinary round sphere is a surface with no handles. This is a surface with one handle, or genus one. It's a donut shape, a torus. But there are more complicated surfaces. Here is a surface with two handles. Here is a surface with three handles. And the pattern continues like that. But there's an important difference between these surfaces. While the sphere is positively curved, all of these surfaces with two or more handles turn out to be negatively curved. And in fact, Manjul Bhargava, who won the Fields Medal at the same time as Maryam, once described her as a master of negatively curved space. So this picture is to give you an idea of Maryam's thesis and how it fits into a broader picture. So she was studying loops on surfaces. So here's a surface with two handles, and here's a loop. This one happens to cross itself, sort of a figure eight. Now, classically, there's something called the prime number theorem, which counts the number of closed loops up to a given length. And it's given by this rapidly growing exponential formula here. What Maryam investigated, however, was what if we only allow loops that do not cross themselves, the so-called simple loops, and these grow much more slowly, and she found the exact order of polynomial growth here. Now, the next slide is the only technical slide I've included, and it's just to give you a hint of what this, this important formula in string theory looks like. It has to do with a complicated integral over moduli space and showing that as the moduli spaces change, these characteristic numbers satisfy some amazing differential equations. But Maryam also proved some elementary statements at the same time as she established this formula. For example, she showed that if you take a random loop on a surface of genus 2, the probability that it cuts it in half, like this one does, is exactly 1/7. In fact, she found all the possible topological statistics of this type for surfaces of any shape. And now, for this major work, which was one of the things recognized by her Fields Medal, I just want to give you a hint of how you connect billiards to surfaces. So this picture depicts the path of an ideal billiard ball bouncing off the sides of a table that's in the shape of a regular pentagon. And to analyze this system, one doubles the table. That is, you take two copies of it and glue it together along an edge. And then instead of having to study the behavior of a ball that bounces when it hits an edge, when it hits this edge, it just goes straight through into the second copy of the table. And in that way, the study of this reflective dynamics is reduced to the study of straight line flow. But you have to do something with the rest of the edges as well. And when you glue them together, you get a surface with two handles again. And the billiard flow goes on to some alternative dynamical system that can be analyzed on this surface. So in this regime, what Maryam proved is that the chaotic behavior that you see in the original billiard table is always tamed by algebraic laws. Now, this breakthrough result did not, however, tell us what those algebraic laws are. And just to give you a hint of the continuing vitality of this field Maryam opened up, I just want to mention many people are investigating what these laws actually are, some of them in the audience, and two recent So two recent breakthroughs in this area are there's a connection now between billiards and algebraic geometry that was totally unexpected. That was discovered in 2016, and even more recently, two new billiard tables with really beautiful properties of their dynamical systems were discovered just this year. Those are cases where we now know what these algebraic laws are and how they influence the behavior of the billiards. I do want to give a hint of the fact that Maryam's work was not limited to the things I can talk about today. She made contributions to a wide variety of areas, one of which was the theory of measured laminations. So I've included this movie made by David Dumas of one of the spaces that she worked with to give you an idea of the worlds that she tried to imagine and manipulate with her creative powers. She also worked on the theory of earthquakes, maybe appropriate for Stanford. This is a kind of very violent way of deforming surfaces. The theory of earthquake deformations looked completely mysterious until Maryam built a bridge between this kind of deformation of surfaces and some much more gentler ways of bending rather than breaking surfaces. And then suddenly the theory of earthquakes became completely transparent when carried across this bridge that she had built. So altogether, I think summing up, I want to say what's really characteristic about Maryam's work is the wide variety of different fields of mathematics that she was able to synthesize into a single transformative program. She was able to absorb all kinds of modern mathematics from graduate students, from postdocs, from professors, from books, and from papers, and she was very adept at mastering these new fields and making them her own. Her deep contributions sparked new mathematical developments that are still unfolding today. So I'd like to end with a picture that is more how I really remember Maryam as a person. And it's not obvious at first when you get to know Maryam, but she was also very tender and also very strong. So this is a picture of her with her daughter, Anahita, helping her work through a drawing book, a puzzle book. And it brings to mind for me something that happened at the ICM in Seoul in 2014 when Maryam received her Fields Medal. I was to give a laudation on Maryam's work to thousands of people. And she was sitting in the front row, and I was a little nervous about how she might receive my description of her great accomplishments. But then I noticed that she had brought Anahita with her to the lecture. And in fact, during the talk, she spent most of her time tending to a very excited little girl. And that memory, too, brings to mind for me a paragraph written by the president of Stanford on this sad occasion, which I think says better than I can how all of us feel. So let me end by quoting that. He wrote, "Maryam is gone far too soon, but her impact will live on for the thousands of women she inspired to pursue math and science. Maryam was a brilliant mathematical theorist and also a humble person who accepted honors only with the hope that it might encourage others to follow her path. Her contributions as both a scholar and a role model are significant and enduring, and she will be dearly missed here at Stanford and around the world."
Hello, I'm Percy Diaconis, a former colleague of Maryam's and a friend of her family. In addition to the shock and sadness surrounding our loss, I'd like to point to some starlight that Maryam left us. Maryam loved the world of Riemann surfaces and spent lots of time way up there in the sky in her moduli spaces. I think it's fair to say that most mathematicians have only a glimmer of what she saw. In the years that she was at Stanford, she let a beam of light shine in my direction. It started with one of her talks, and we later pursued it in ongoing work. And I'd like to try to let that light shine out here. So in some version of English, the issue is, Kurt just showed pictures of Riemann surfaces. There are lots of them, and you can take all of them with a given number of holes and fit them all together, and that's the set of all moduli space, that's moduli space. And one of the things that Maryam investigated in her thesis and afterward was the fact that there's a way of picking a Riemann surface at random, and she studied what does such a thing look like. And I want to try to bring this to life for you just for a moment. The simplest case is a torus, and that is a donut, but it's like an inner tube. And as Kurt was saying, you could take that inner tube and snip it. It's an inner tube. You could snip it, make it into an ordinary tube, and then you could cut it along this way and open it out, and I'm not supposed to touch that, and then have it be a flat piece of paper. So picture the torus as a square. And now, I don't have graphics, so you're going to have to do this with your mind, but I think we all can. Here's a square. And now suppose I put two lines down here and two lines that way, okay? Then it would become nine squares, right? Two lines this way, two lines this way, there are nine squares. If I put a little if I put a diagonal edge in each of the squares, I have 18 triangles. Now if I glued that back together, that would be what you saw pictures of, a triangulation of the torus. So I'm almost where I can explain what the issue is. I just said you could do it with 18 instead of breaking it into three on each side. If you broke it into 1,000 on each side, and did what I just said, you'd have, well, if it was 1,000 by 1,000, you'd have something like 1,000,000 little triangles. Okay. One more idea is needed. I hope you can picture 1,000,000 little triangles, all neatly arranged. Now, I need a random Riemann surface. I need a random triangulation. And here's one way of saying that. Take any of the edges, say an edge this way, one of the little edges of the triangle, and erase it. There were two triangles that met along that edge. If you erase the edge, there's a quadrilateral. So you could put in the opposite edge, and that would get a different triangulation. You could do that again and again and again, starting from the neat triangulation, and if you kept replacing edges with their opposites, you'd get a mess, but it would tend to a random triangulation, and that's a good picture to have of a random Riemann surface of genus 1. Okay, now try to picture again my square with 1,000 lines this way, 1,000 lines that way, and all the little triangles going in there. Here's a typical question. What's the diameter? So let me try to explain that. Take two triangles, and suppose you want to know how can you get from here to here? How many steps does it take to get from here to here? Well, it's just 1,000 by 1,000, so at the worst you have to do is go over 1,000, and then up 1,000, and so the diameter is something like 2,000. And so that's for the neat triangulation. If you take a random triangulation, you can ask the same question. Take two triangles, what's the diameter? And it's quite surprising, it's the type of question that Maryam worked on, it's quite surprising that the diameter of a random triangulation is about 30. So it's tiny, it's the square root of 1,000. And what to keep in mind is that this random triangulation is nothing like anything you can picture. And that's the world that Maryam lived in. Somehow she could picture how they would go, and she was studying how random Riemann surfaces looked. When it gets dark, we can look up and see the light of the stars. For me, Maryam is a constant source of light. I'm planning to spend a while with some of Maryam's colleagues to try to see what she left us. I think that there are hundreds of mathematicians, maybe thousands, all over the world planning something similar. I think she left something for all of us. It might not be the kind of mathematics I just talk about. It might be her life or some other part of her mathematics. But I do think she left something for all of us, and I give thanks for her.
Hello, my name is Alex Wright, and I'm a postdoc here at Stanford. I remember vividly the first time I met Maryam. It was in her office at Stanford, and I was visiting as a graduate student. I sat on the couch opposite her blackboard, and her blackboard was covered in mathematical equations and doodles, layered in them. Whenever she needed to write something, she would erase only the smallest portion of the board possible, and she would squeeze her writing into that small space. She spoke excitedly, sharing her ideas without reservation. Sometimes she repeated herself, sometimes she abandoned a sentence midway through, and her thoughts came out somewhat in a jumble. As her former student Jenya Sapir puts it, she would present different ideas like a cast of characters, all talking to each other. As I started to grasp the depth of her understanding and vision, I felt awe. 2 years later, I was back in that same office, having just moved to Stanford to work with Maryam. She was so eager to get to work that she arranged for me to stay in a hotel for the week before my lease began so that we could get started that much earlier. We would discuss mathematics for hours at a time, standing at her blackboard, sometimes pacing in excitement or concentration. She was always optimistic. As her student Ben Dozier recalls, she would find some aspect of any question, even if naive, to be fascinating. Her enthusiasm was infectious. I would leave our meetings determined, even if the mathematical challenges we faced were daunting. Maryam was not intimidated, and with her working with me, any fear of failure evaporated. I was energized to work on problems that previously I would have judged to be too difficult even to attempt. We had lunch together frequently, always at the business school cafeteria right next to this auditorium. There, our mathematical discussions would pause. Maryam would speak of her daughter, Anahita, and of the joys and challenges of being a parent. She spoke of teaching and complained that she couldn't stick with just one textbook, so that whenever she taught, her house would be littered in different textbooks. She rarely gave advice and spoke in mildly worded suggestions rather than instructions. On career issues, like the best place to submit a paper or how to get the best job, she was often silent. Perhaps as a result of her own meteoric career, she had different firsthand experience of such struggles. But more than that, she radiated a sense of perspective and focus, as if the adversities she faced had taught her that which journal accepts a paper is not the most important thing, and as if her intellectual curiosity dwarfed academic politics. She once told me, "Know what you want and don't get distracted." She seemed to follow that advice herself. After she was awarded the Fields Medal, she wanted to get right back to thinking deeply. She tried to ignore reporters and the press coverage and seemed unchanged by her newfound recognition and celebrity. But she did want to help fellow mathematicians, especially young mathematicians. One of the graduate students here at Stanford, Pedram Safi, contracted her from Iran as a high school student. They had never met, but still she took the time to respond with advice on studying mathematics. Recently, Maryam became an editor for one of the most prestigious journals in mathematics. Most papers submitted to this journal are rejected, and the review process is very long. Maryam told me over and over again, "I just want to accept a paper. I just want to press the accept button." When Maryam's cancer recurred, she wanted to keep working. Instead of her office, we'd meet at the Cooper Cafe in front of Green Library, closer to her home. Between the meetings, now much less frequent, I was sad and worried, knowing that her medical situation was dire. But when I saw her in person, even when she spoke of her struggles, I felt almost elated. Maryam was still herself, still curious, brilliant, perseverant, and brave, and the force of her optimism would make me feel, if only briefly, as if she would surely be okay. Now, as we mourn her, I want to remember the beauty and power of her mathematics and the force of her personality, which could convince me, even as she was in pain, to smile.
Hi everyone, my name is Mohsen Namju, with my dear old friend CEMEX Sanayi from Palo Alto. We're supposed to play two songs. And at some point doesn't make sense at all to having a musician here for the program. But I was told by dear Leila, Maryam's sister, that two songs of mine was a part of Professor Mirzakhani's favorite songs. That's why we're gonna play those two songs for you today. And doesn't need to say that I'm really pleased and honored to playing today here.
Thank you.
خدا دل لال زارون بر من بباره ای خدا دل لال زارون
Thank you. شب یکی کس را شاه نمیبی هر یک بتر از دیگر شوریده و دیدی دیدی دیوانه شوریده و دیدی دیدی شوریده و دیدی دیدی دیوانه شوریده و دیدی دیدی آخر آخر با تو تا لذت جان 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 بینی آن چه خوشی 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 باشه بی صحبت جان جان جانانه اون کشتی بیه بیه بی لنگه کش می شد و مج می شد و مج می شد در هر نظرش زرش زرش مزمن صد گلشن و کان و کاشانه جان را چه خوشی 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 باشد بی صحبت جان جا جان صحبت جان جا جان بی صحبت جان جا جان بی صحبت جان جا جان تو دیوانه ما را که برد 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 خانه صد بار تو را گفتم کم خور دو سه دو سه دو سه پیمانه من مست و تو دیوانه ما را که برد 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 خانه صد بار تو را گفتم کم خور دو سه دو سه در شهر یکی کس را هوشیار نمی‌بینم هر یک بتر از دیگر شوریده و دیدی دیدی شوریده و دیدی دیدی بربط زن تو مستری یا من ای پیش چو تو مستی افسون من افسانه گفتم که رفیقی کن با من که من ایت خیشم گفتا که به نشناسم من خیش زبیگان
Thank you so much.
My name is Yahya Tabesh. I am going to talk about teenage Maryam. I met her for the first time in a summer camp, math summer camp at Sharif University of Technology in Tehran, Iran. She came there, she was 15, I believe, the first time I met her at this math camp. And it was a bunch of students in the math camp, but she was so highly motivated and energetic and brought attention of all students, other students and other prof and teachers that were in the math camp. She was very extraordinary. It happened some challenges to being for them in this math camp. Prof at Sharif, a colleague of mine, Abad Mahmoudian, brought to their attention this problem in a very simple cases. Brought this challenge for the students in the math camp. And just the composition of complete tripartite graphs into five cycles. We had a simple version in a local, in National Math Olympiad, but this was not proven yet. And Abad brought it to the attention of the students in the math camp and in simple cases and put some prizes for them. And later on, it was Maryam that solved it. And it was her first publication in when she was a high school student and appeared in 1995 in Combinatorics at one. Later on, she joined Mathematical Olympiad in 1994 and 1995. And I was director of the Math Olympiad at that period in Iran. And she had the national gold medal. Later on, you know all, she attended the International Mathematical Olympiad two times with gold medals and full scores and et cetera. It was very interesting for us and exciting to look how they are working on the problems, how she managed working on hard problems and solving hard problems. It was really interesting for me and too exciting to see how they are looking for these hard problems. After that, after Olympiads, she joined, we asked her to join the National Mathematical Olympiad Committee and help us to go through new training the new students. She was a problem in problem creation and resource development. She was really active. She wrote with Roya this a number theory book for the training of Math Olympiad training sessions. Still, it is using this in 12 printing, I think, and they are using it as a reference for that. And it was so exciting for me to sit with her and we create new problems for the next session of Olympiads. It was always very exciting. Later on, she joined as an undergrad to the mathematics department of Sharif University of Technology in Tehran, Iran. And in that period, I used to be chairman of the math department at Sharif. And we, with few colleagues of mine at Sharif, we really made a movement to attract many many interested and many good students to come to mathematics major. And Maryam was a star among them. She was really, in all classes, she was very good. And I have to say, few colleagues of mine made this happen as a center of excellence in Iran. I have to remember, Maryam was always remembering Siavash Shahjahani, pioneer mathematician in Iran. She taught her, I think Maryam had three courses with her. with him, with Siavash, and always remembering first dynamical system courses that he had with Siavash. Later on, she was always remembering another young faculty at that time, Bahman Khanedani, the very good course in geometrical point of view brought to her, develop more intuition about geometrical point of view for her, and she was always remembering in this class also. I have to say this movement happened. A bunch of very good students attracted to the mathematics department of Sharif University of Technology. We had a bunch of very good students. They organized a math circle. It was all of the sudden in the corner of math department. We had a circle round, and they gathered there, and a math circle as a club to talk mathematically happened to be there. And I have to say a community raised over there. It was a community over there. And they were talking mathematically there and discussing many different mathematical problem set. I remember they were studying alphas, and a problem was on the table. They made a problem, f and g to complete analytic function and such and such, and f or g, f, either f is constant or g is linear. This was the problem on the table. And Maryam was the person, the one who she wrote 5 pages and made the proof completely. They had really enjoyable time, and it was really enjoyable for us to looking at them and to look at Maryam, that how they are growing up. And we have a national math contest for college students in college level in Iran. Maryam went there in 1998, and she was the first, received gold medal, and she was the first in that contest. The contest was in southern inner city, in the southern part of Tehran. In the way back, the bad thing happened, bus accident in March 1998. And a bunch of six, seven students passed away in this one. Maryam survived. The guy with white shirts is Mojtaba. He was in the bus and he passed away. He was one of the leader of the students over there. We were a family over there. And more challenges was on the table for the students in these various classes. A young faculty at that time was Saeed Akbari. He brought this old problem of Paul Erdős to the attention of the I think it was an algebraic graph class, and he brought this problem. This is a more than 20 years old problem was by Erdős. He brought to the attention of the students and put, I think, a $10 prize for them. And Maryam was the one who made it and solved it, and he appeared it in BICA as a very, and still is very nice example that she made. And the thing is that after the paper published, she was an undergrad, and the paper published, she received a letter from National Science Foundation in US that they asked her to evaluate a grant proposal. And they addressed Professor Mirzakhani. She was undergrad, and they asked her to evaluate a related grant proposal. So after that, she finished in undergrad at Sharif, and you know she went to Harvard, and you know the rest of the stories of her. But I had the chance to be here at Stanford for recently, and I got the chance to be more and more with her, and we had a lot of discussion and meeting with each other. Somehow often we had lunch over here and talking about various things. She was we talked about various concepts about it, educational concepts. And we were always talking how we can develop a new system in education. She remembered for the first time in the math camp that she entered, and she received the first motivation to go for mathematics. And she was always supporting this kind of idea. And we were talking how we can develop such a movement more and more widely in, globally, I have to say. And she had a lot of social concerns. She was telling that she see in future, she had the concern that she can, in future, can be part of more administrative jobs in, foundations or in National Academy of Science, etc., and can have a role after doing much more mathematics, that she was really loved to do that and solving hard problems. We had meeting and we had somehow lunch in the food court next to this auditorium, and it is really hard now standing here and talk about her. But I had her energy. I have her energy, and I have her dreams with us to make a better world. Thank you so much.
I'm Kasra Rafi. I was a friend of Maryam for a long time. I also met Maryam early on in this Olympiad camp. Yeah, he was talking about. So I'll tell you some of the early stories and some of the later ones. So I was teaching them as a former Olympiad person. And then so Maryam was a really good student. So the challenge was to find something she cannot do. And so we were always giving her harder and harder problems and more interesting things to do. So a bunch of these problems you couldn't solve yourself. But anyway, so you throw it out there and see what happens. And then, so I gave her a particularly hard problem. And I remember, so the solution came out. And I was an early undergrad there. And so I looked at the solution, and I can't follow it at all. I have no idea what it says. So I kind of know it's complex analysis, but I mean, there's no way. So I have to go pick up a book in complex analysis and read it for a day or two. And I was going to say that this is nonsense, but it looked kind of okay. So I digged into it, and I eventually learned, the complex integrations and how to compute residues and so on. And I see it's all correct. So I'm extremely impressed. I go back to her, and I'm like, yeah, I mean, this is very long, complicated proof. It's not what I had in mind, but it seems correct. But I mean, she's at high school now. I'm like, how did you learn complex analysis? And she was like, oh, I don't know what's going on there. I just found this other paper which did some proof. It was kind of like similar. So I picked it up, I changed it, and I wanted to see if it's right. So I just sent it to you. And so this is the story of how I learned complex analysis, just because of talking to her. So this relationship kind of continued, and I was very happy that she was kind of coming to my field. So then she came to Harvard, and she was going to Kurt's classes, and also at the same time Joe Harris's classes, and she was wondering if I should be algebraic geometer or like maybe do 3-1 surfaces. So, I felt I can still like be a mentor. I can like maybe I told her yeah, it takes a long time sometimes. All these things are very hard to understand, and you go to these classes, you don't understand what's going on. And she was telling me that algebraic geometry is hard. I don't understand it, and I was like, yes, that's kind of true. It takes you a few years to digest everything, but you should do this. This is very nice. So I showed her some fun stuff. At the same time feeling calm, because it took me a long time to adjust to a new country, to adjust to a new culture, I would go to seminars and not understand anything. And then here is Maryam going to seminar not understanding anything. So I was very happy about that. but the problem was in a year or two, she was just, beyond reach. So she faced all the same challenges as the rest of us. But she just moved through them much, much more quickly. And it's not like everything in her life was perfect. I mean, I remember when she finished her thesis is really amazing. And then so she was like, well, I talked to Kurt and said, oh, she divided three pieces and sent one to annals and one to gems and one to inventions. I'm like, okay, that's that sounds very reasonable. And then she was like, what if it's all wrong? like what's going to happen actually? And you know, so she had those fears that everybody has, and insecurities. I mean, she went to Princeton afterwards, and so she was supposed to be a genius, and then she knew that she was supposed to be a genius. And then and you go to Princeton, and people like Sarnak and Lindenstrauss, and you know, they would come and talk to her, and they expect her to be a genius. And she was like, I know all these people, you know, want something. I have to show up there, and I have to be a genius. And it's not easy, you know, it's not easy. I mean, people have thought about problems for years, and then they just come to you, and you're this young person, and you're supposed to digest it. So she felt all the anxieties, and just she managed to just pass through them way more quickly than you can imagine. And it's like, you know, you don't live in a vacuum. I mean, everybody has a support system. I think beside the people that in Iran that Dr. Tabush mentioned, I mean, I think her support system was, I should mention, is like Kurt and Alex Eskin and Jan, especially. They shielded her from so much, and then so they let her do what she's good at and what she wants to do. So that is very important. But my relationship with her was kind of like, she was my support system. So I went to her when I was at crisis or when I felt insecure. I didn't know what to do. And she would, you know, she would listen to my problems, digest them very quickly, and tell me what to do. Like, I liked that so much. She just very, I mean, she could, yeah. I mean, besides being really clever and fast in math, she was very clever and math in a lot of things. So it's very nice to see all these people here. And then so, you know, I was in a cab coming here, and then he was telling me that he didn't know who Maryam was, but because of this event, just read about her and just was inspired so much and was so excited. And, you know, sometimes you don't realize what some person means to you until you lose them. So I felt that very much. I mean, now that she's not here, I mean, it's like the hole is really huge. And then everybody comes to me and then they tell me, oh, I sat next to her and then she talked to me and she treated me like a human being. And then it made me feel so much better. And everything I did so much better. I mean, everything she touched, I think she made better. Everywhere she went, she was loved. And I see all the love in this room. So it's really great. Everybody's here. Just miss her very much. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Roya Beheshti, and I met Maryam on an autumn day 29 years ago. It was the second day of middle school. We met as I walked out of our school's library and saw her standing by the door. She told me later that she had liked the serious expression on my face, carrying some books. We quickly became close friends, and for the next 7 years at the school, we sat next to each other at a shared desk. We attended Sharif University in Tehran together, moved to Boston for graduate school together, and always remained important parts of each other's lives. I treasure the shared experiences I had with Maryam, and I would like to share some of the memories that I had with her with you now through a few photos. Thank you.
This is Maryam and I in the ninth grade, in the school's library. The first time we met was right outside this library. Here, we are in the 10th grade. Maryam is sitting in the front row. In the back are some of our classmates, along with the principal of our school, who is on the right, and one of our math teachers in the center. This is 1994. Here we are with some of the students and instructors at the Math Olympiad preparation camp. This was the first year female students got to go to the math camp. And this is a photo of the math team. Maryam was so strong that it always felt empowering to be with her. And she had such a contagious passion for math. It always felt good to just sit by her and talk about math or do math. Maryam was the only woman in the Math Olympiad team the year after, 1995. This is somewhere by the Caspian Sea. Here we are at a student conference in Ahvaz in south of Iran in our junior year in college. Our bus got into an accident on our way back to Tehran, and several of our friends were killed or injured. We are lucky we had Maryam as long as we did. We moved to Boston in 1999. For my first birthday in the US, Maryam and another friend organized a small surprise get-together. This is somewhere at Harvard University. Here is Maryam's dorm at Harvard, March 2000, sometime around the Iranian New Year. We are having homemade Persian food after a very long time. This one is a happy summer day in Cape Cod, summer of 2000. We took several trips to New York City together, this time to go to a concert. And here we are meeting with our other Iranian math friends who lived in the New York area. And this is a trip to the Grand Canyon during the winter break of 2002. Here we are celebrating Maryam's birthday, May 2002 in Boston. This is at Oxford in October 2015. Maryam is giving a talk before being awarded the Clay Research Award. This is the last time I heard her give a talk, and probably one of the last talks that she gave. We laughed with her after the talk, since she, as always getting forgetful when absorbed in math, had completely forgotten to use the rest of the boards in the lecture hall and stayed at that corner during the entire talk. This is the last trip we took to New York City together and the very last photo that I have of Maryam, March 2017. We are at a coffee shop in Upper East Side meeting with our friend Kia, drinking coffee and enjoying a good conversation. Maryam was not keen on being photographed in recent years. Here we agreed on a photo having her only halfway in. This was a stressful day because Maryam had been given a report of the progress of her cancer earlier that day. But Maryam was being herself, engaging, interesting, and focused on the positive. I have looked at this picture many times since July, and each time it has brought me a smile, thinking of the time we had together. She had such a strong, courageous, positive personality that could even handle a stressful situation like this with grace. And this is what I'm going to miss the most about her, a tremendously strong friend. Anytime I talk to her, no matter what, I ended up with an uplifted spirit and more positive energy.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming. I'm Leila, honored to be Maryam's sister. I'm blessed raising up beside Maryam in a home that I can call it heaven. It was really heaven, full of calmness, love, respect. We were four, Arash, me, Maryam, and Ali. My mother, a strong woman who sacrificed life for four of us. Her manner had been always adored by Maryam. My father, a strong man whose determination to raise us in no feeling superior to the norm of the society, humble and caring for people in need. Our childhood was past full of joys. We get meaning of life from our parents' manners. Maryam was a playful, lovely girl, very industrious, self-disciplined, and focused on her wishes. She was so thirsty for learning, reading books bigger than her hands. And me and Arash were older than her. Specifically with Arash, she was very interested to discuss math problems, the things that had been in the school materials. Arash is 6 years older than Maryam. And even she was very interested to discuss the economical and political situations. I mean, the cases in our country, you know how. I remember this clear image, seeing Maryam lying on the ground before just taking off her shoes, returning from school. She was just stretching out on the ground, finishing her homework, and then said, "Hi, so I'm back home." So first, it was the homeworks. Home was all prepared for studying, but nothing else. All mom and dad clearly always expect from four of us was to be the best of ourselves, which was for Maryam, as you know, being a mathematician, as you know. I'm happy she had used all she had in the best way. I'm so thankful of my mom and dad. She has been raised perfect to achieve this much respect. I'm thankful for all her teachers, the school staffs, and university professors, friends, and also her medical team and doctors who played a great role in her path. And I have special thanks and respect to Jan, who I can witness how gratefully he was supporting Maryam, especially in the sad and hard moments. It was terrible. Also, I'm so much thankful to Stanford for organizing this memorial. I know that how much hard work you've been doing. The points that made me admire her are further than her achievements. I saw how vividly she saw her wishes possible, how bravely she walked through it, how courageous she was in setting her own rules for life. And then when she found the real, real meaning for her life, how determined she was to staying on it. How greatly she managed to stay silent when achieving the success, trying not to be disturbed, I mean, not distracted by anything else. How beautifully she was fulfilling her motherhood while struggling to stay up, I mean, top high in academically. And then facing the strong cancer, how strong she was, trying to find ways, studying about her, the main problem, and studying all the things that have been in very front, I mean, the whatever it has been happening in medicine. How picky she was to choose her best treatment thanks to her doctors. How patiently she was tolerating the pain she was suffering. I admire her for setting beautiful boundary for her own family privacy. Anahita and Jan were her very, very top priorities. And these are something I learned from her, observing her manners during the last year of her life, which I've had this honor to be very close to her. Take the life easy in its materials, but try hard to make it deep. Respect each other's privacy. Respect the body by sport and what you eat. Mind what you take into your soul, what you watch and listen to. She had beautiful mind, great soul, and I'm happy she will be remembered by whoever their heart has been touched by her love to life and math. Losing Maryam is a great pain. It's such a grief that I cannot say it's easy to forget or even tolerate. I sought for any remedy if I can heal my pain. I found it in some interpretation of life and death. I like this simile. This earth life is as a fetus, and death is birth, but to another stage of life. No way for fetus to find the meaning of all this process, but we all know it's an inevitable growth. Hafez are great poet of Persian language. For me, it seems that he said these verses for Maryam. هرگز نمیرد آنکه دلش زنده شد به عشق ثبت است بر جریده عالم دوام او. The one whose heart has been once alive by love would never die, as her name would be embedded on the scene of eternity. Hope she rests in peace. Maryam, I love you. This is not to be ended. I mean, the love that you had made in my love, it cannot be ended. And I hope you would be always be resting in peace, at last tolerating that great amount of pain. And there is a piece of poem, it's in Farsi. I'm sorry I cannot read it in English. Hope the Iranian enjoyed. زخاک من اگر گندم براید از آن گر نانپزی مستی فزاید. خمیر و نانوا دیوانه گردد. تنورش بیت مستانه سراید. اگر برگور من آری زیارت تو را خرپشتم رقصان نماید. میا بیدف به گور من برادر که در بزم خدا غمگین نشاید. مرا حق از می عشق آفریده است. همان عشقم مگر اگر مرگم بساید. من آن مستی و وصل من می عشق بگو از می به جز مستی چه آید. Thank you so much.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jan von Drack, Maryam's husband. First of all, thanks to all of you for coming here. And I want to thank all the speakers for their beautiful words. So when I was preparing this speech, I was trying to think, what can I possibly add to all these beautiful things that have been uttered here? So let me just say a few things about Maryam that I remember. We met in Boston, and we were grad students, and I had no idea that she was a superstar. She was, as has been mentioned here, she was pretty modest. She was saying, I'm writing up my thesis, and I think I have enough to graduate now. It should be fine. Also, she was writing up some papers, so okay, she was a very nice girl. Then I learned a little bit more about it later, but she didn't talk about her own work too much. She was mostly talking about the work of other people, mathematics that she really enjoyed and loved and that she wanted to expand on. It sounded like she had so many plans, it would take her 100 years to do all of that. So I was wondering, how is she going to do it? Well, she managed to do quite a lot. So let me actually skip to the last few years. She received a lot of letters from all kinds of places, her fans around the world. Little girls who were asking, you know, how did you achieve all of that? How did you get motivated? Where did you find the inspiration? How did you get to this place? How did you become the first woman to win the Fields Medal? And you know, she didn't like that question too much. How did you win the Fields Medal? The right question to ask is, how did she love her work so much that she didn't care? She really didn't care so much. And to be fair, she cared about the prizes to the extent that her peers really admired and respected her work. But all the publicity, she really didn't care. And, when she heard about the Fields Medal, she said, oh my God, this is going to be crazy. And she was right. I mean, she knew what was coming. But really, she only wanted to do her work very well. She wanted to understand difficult problems, find connections, you know, clean up confusion. I don't think she even wanted to solve a problem at any cost. She wanted to really find something nice, to find a connection, to find a structure, to find something beautiful in it. And that's how she was. So when she was reflecting on her really terrible misfortune when she was diagnosed with cancer, she was saying, well, life is not fair. When I was born in loving family. I was born with a smart head. I was born with good people around me. I didn't complain either how unfair it is. You know, many people in the world don't have all these things. So why should I complain now? And she really didn't complain about anything ever. So she said, you know, don't be too quick to cry for me. There's a lot of trouble in the world, actually, especially now. Cry for those who are close to you that you can actually help. She didn't want to be seen as a victim. Now, she was described as a role model, and I was thinking quite a bit about what that means. So a role model, maybe somebody in whose footsteps you're supposed to follow. Well, maybe, but Maryam was not an easy person to imitate. She was quite special. You know, she she didn't care a lot about many things that people enjoy, celebrations, parties, you know, she didn't have a lot of time for it. She knew exactly what she wanted to do. She had a very clear plan. And she didn't worry about what people say. You know, some people criticize her, she didn't care. She really knew what she wanted to do. She had a very strong mind. By the way, our life was not just math. She was a very good swimmer. She would beat me at swimming even like 6 months before she passed away. She was still faster. She would have loved to run the marathon one day. That was her dream. Never happened. She loved public radio, I want to say that. Her favorite show was This American Life. She liked stories of people who were different, maybe less fortunate. She really felt strongly about, you know, people who are not so lucky. And she felt actually that she was in some ways lucky. Unfortunately, at the end, she was pretty unlucky. So I want to say to the young people who are watching and who ask these questions, what would Maryam say? Well, yes, she was a role model, but I don't think it means that you should try to be exactly like her. It's quite hard. But in any case, you have to find your own path. You have to find what you love. You have to find what you are good at and what is meaningful to you. And if you do it well, then you would have made Maryam happy. Okay, so we have one more thing for you. Very happy to introduce Maktab Behakhehi, final singer of the program. She will sing a song called Jane Maryam for you. Please welcome Maktab Behakhehi.
Hello, I'm Mahtab, Maryam's cousin, and I'm honored to be here and sing this song for Maryam. It's called Jane Maryam, and also, sorry, we would like to thank from the composer Kambiz Mujdehi and from Reza Rohani for the arrangement. Thank you. Oh,
نازنین مریم. بیارسید وقت درو مال منی از پیشم نرو،
as our time together comes to a close, we spend just a few moments in silence, remembering all that Maryam meant to each one of us here. And so we give thanks for Maryam's life, knowing that we take forward into the future all that she gave to the world, her love for family and friends, the mentorship and inspiration she gave to students and colleagues, her groundbreaking, brilliant research in mathematics, her optimism, her imagination, her determination, and her joy. Thank you.